Would you please stand as we turn together to Psalm 126 and read from the Word of the Lord. This month is often a time of emphasis on love, for many romance, but we celebrate the greatest love of all, amen? I would encourage you to turn your attention to Psalm 126, and we begin reading today at verse 1. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dreamed. Our mouths were filled with laughter, our tongues with songs of joy. Then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy. Restore our fortunes, Lord, like the streams of Negev. Those who sow with tears will reap with songs of joy. Those who go out weeping, carrying seed to sow, will return with songs of joy, carrying sheaves with them. Would you bow your heads with me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you for the truth of your word. The moments in our lives where our journey seems to parallel the example that we find in great men and women of faith. And for the moments of our lives when we read of joy that seems so far away, and we know that we can trust in you to lift the burden, to lighten the load, to restore our fortunes. May your word speak to every heart this morning. In Christ Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Well, I was looking for Craig and Carly Nathan this morning because they are celebrating their 40th anniversary today. I was looking, but apparently they decided to slip away. So if you see them this week, you wish them a happy anniversary. 40 years is a great milestone. You know, this morning, as we read this passage of Scripture from Psalm 126, we see a realistic and relevant example that I believe that God holds out for you and me in such a time as this. As we have been focusing on love and laughter, sometimes we find ourselves swinging one way or the other. I don't know about you, but sometimes I feel like Tarzan. Not like that. But you know how he swings through the jungle on those vines? How many of you have ever felt that exhilaration, that rush, when God was doing something great in your life, and it seemed like there were no boundaries and no limits to what God could do? How many of you know what that feels like? Oh! And then you realize that if you hold on to that vine any longer, you're going to smack into a tree. Ka-thud. Now, that's like George of the Jungle, right? Watch out for that tree. Something has to happen. We have to let go. And there's that brief moment when you're swinging on vines in the jungle, and you're holding on to nothing but the promise that your grip will not fail when you grab a hold of that next opportunity. That God will somehow carry you forward. Now, I know for many, even bringing up this topic of Tarzan makes you think, I do not know where he's going today, but I'm ready to get off the train. That's not me. I'm not a swinging from vines in the jungle kind of person. I'm a stand with my feet firmly rooted on the ground kind of person. I get that. I married one of those. Isn't it amazing how God gives us everything we need? He provides over and over again opportunities. And sometimes we can't see beyond this moment in time, and yet God already has something waiting for us. He has exactly what we need. I would encourage you today that wherever you are in life, whatever has brought you to this moment, that God isn't finished with you yet. I know that God isn't finished with you yet because many of your eyes are open right now. Because you're breathing and you are here. And that's enough evidence for me that God isn't finished with you yet. Maybe you and I need to experience once again what it is to dream God-sized dreams. In Psalm 126, verses 1 and the beginning of verse 2, we read, when the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dreamed. Our mouths were filled with laughter, our tongues with songs of joy. You see, God-sized dreams may seem too big to be true, but he's a big, big God. And nothing is too big for him. There are several Hebrew words for dream. The particular word that is found here in Psalm 126, 1, is chalom. It can be a dream that's either ordinary or prophetic. It can be used in either context. But chalom also means to be healthy, to be strong, to have one's health restored. Friends, I want to encourage you that whatever you've experienced, whatever you've gone through, whatever seems impossible to you, perhaps God is waiting to do something that only he can do. Perhaps you need to hold on to a God-sized dream. That requires you and me to let go of what feels comfortable, of what we can do ourselves, of what we can accomplish ourselves. Sometimes, to let go and abandon selfish dreams. In Isaiah chapter 29, verse 8, we read, as when a hungry person dreams, chalom, of eating, but awakens still hungry. As when a thirsty person dreams, chalom, of drinking, but awakens faint and still thirsty. So will it be for the hordes of all the nations that fight against Mount Zion. See, when we fight against God's will, when we refuse to pursue the opportunities that he puts in front of us, when we hold back the floods that God is bringing to wash away all that this world has erected to distract and deter us. When you and I only dream of the things we could accomplish on our own, when we only dream of the things that will make our lives easier, the things that give us a sense of fulfillment, we miss out. We miss out on the greater opportunities that God has in front of us. But it takes a moment of letting go and putting our faith, our trust completely in him and embracing eternal dreams. In Genesis chapter 28, a man named Jacob, who was later renamed Israel after he famously wrestled with the angel of the Lord, he had a dream. In Genesis 28:12 says that he had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth, with its top reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. In this dream, God made some promises to Jacob, to Israel. First, to give Jacob and his descendants the land. The land represented wealth in that day, represented provision, health. Everything they needed was in the land and on the land. And God promised, I will give you and your descendants the land. The second promise that God made was to multiply his descendants and spread them across the earth. Today, the descendants of Jacob, the people of Israel, on every continent. And there have been many efforts to destroy them and annihilate all of God's people, and yet they have survived and thrived and flourished. And not just the physical descendants of Jacob, but the spiritual descendants. You see, God also promised Jacob in that dream to bless all people of the earth through his descendants. Remember, Jesus was a direct descendant of Jacob. And all people of the earth are blessed with the opportunity to receive the free gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ. And finally, God promised Jacob to never leave him until his promise had been fulfilled. Can I tell you, friends, God will never leave you. He will never let you down. The promise he made to Jacob is as true for you and me today. He will fulfill every promise. In this life, or on the day when he says, well done, good and faithful servant, and he returns to each one of us, that perfect state, that new body, where every one of us, regardless of how we've beat ourselves up or what's been done to us, will have the strength, the ability, the energy to swing through the jungles on vines if we want to. I don't know if heaven has a jungle, but I'll swing through heaven on vines. I'll take that new body, Lord, and do with it as he pleases. You see, God gives us a joyful testimony. I love Psalm 126, the latter part of verse 2. It says, then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. Verse 3 continues, the Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy. You notice that the ancients, the great psalmists, spoke of how God had blessed them, and people took note. People took note of how God was working in people's lives. Some who were far off didn't criticize, didn't hurl insults, didn't make war, but they said something special is happening there. God had blessed them. Many came to faith in the one true God because he saw the way that he had provided. And as all the chatter was going on, the focus wasn't on the criticism. The focus wasn't on the condemnation. It was probably there too. But the focus was on the fact that the message of God's provision was getting out. The hope that only comes through the one true God. And then that affirmation. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy. Can I tell you, today we are going to celebrate, when this service ends, what God has done just in the last year through this church. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy. People, we have reason to celebrate because God has done great things for us. And faithfulness spreads joy. Now, I have to tell you that this last week I have struggled physically. Got a little bug in the air. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Got a little sinus thing going on, a little fever, up in the triple digits, not the high triple digits, don't get me wrong. There was a one at the beginning and a zero. Aches and pains all over my body. You know what I'm talking about? And all I could think was, man, I just want one of those sick days. My son just had one. I want one of those sick days. If I could just finish this little report for the annual business meeting, if I could just finish this little video with some of the pictures of what God has done over the last year, then I'll get that rest. And you know what happened? As I started diving into it and looking at what God has done, I started feeling the power of the Holy Spirit working through me. And I don't know if you knew this or not, but God's power is more intense and more mighty than congestion. And if I'm going to be awake at night, I don't have to be awake at night coughing and wheezing. I can be awake at night celebrating God's goodness. If I'm going to wake up in the middle of the night hurting, I can think about those in our church family who feel aches and pains every day and press through it with joy. See, faithfulness spreads joy. In John's third epistle, he addressed Gaius, whose name comes from a Latin word meaning to rejoice. And in biblical references, it can also mean Lord in an earthly sense. John describes how the faithfulness of Gaius was a source of great joy to him. In 3 John verses 3 and 4, we read, "It gave me great joy when some believers came and testified about your faithfulness to the truth, telling how you continue to walk in it. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth." You catch that? Bloated bank account? Nah, that's not as good. A new pair of shoes? That's pretty good. Not as good. Fine. Automobile. Lots of horsepower under the hood that somebody else polishes for you. That's not as good. Swimming pool in the backyard? Mm-mm. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. Every parent in this room should be able to relate to that statement. You know, just last week, my family went to a dangerous place, a mall. And I did it because I love my wife. And the kids were there, and I said to my son, I said, "Listen, buddy, we got to have a strategy here. It's you and me. If there's a Lego store or a Disney store in this mall, we're there. Abigail can come with us if she wants. She stayed with mom." That's how the girl rolls. She stayed with mom right until we got to the door of the mall, and she said, "I'm going to go and do the Disney store and the Lego store." We burned through. There was no Lego store. We burned through the Disney store. We looked at everything they had. We talked about it. They did the math in their heads to figure out what they might be able to get on their own. We started going down the mall looking for other stores of interest. And we found this little gift shop. And we went inside, and my kids gravitated towards something that my wife does not love. Plush toys. Aniansi calls them a hotbed for germs. Plush toys. You know, those soft little disease catchers and spreaders. The things that smell like drool in the morning. Plush toys. Oh, my kids love them. We've been trying to get it out of their system for years to no avail. And we managed to distract. We got in the car. We went to lunch. But we were still close to the mall, and Abigail kept talking about this one toy. And I thought, I just can't deny her this toy. I can't. I mean, she's not stopped talking about it. She wants to spend her own money on it. I can't deny it. So my daughter went, and she got plush Jesus. Now, I had to straighten out a little bit of the theology because she said, now I can have Jesus with me all the time. I said, baby, you can always have Jesus with you all the time. But this is cute. And he can remind you of the Jesus you don't see with your eyes, but who lives in your heart. And so this little plush Jesus has ridden on the scooter with Abigail. He went to school with her, though we got him out of the backpack before she, you know, went inside. And this morning when she got up really early and said, Dad, can I go and pray with you this morning? She asked if she could bring plush Jesus. And I thought, you know, I need something to hold up during my message today. To just bring a little joy. How many of you know that Jesus brings joy? If you don't, see Abigail after church. Ask her for permission to give him a hug, because spread of germs. If she says it's okay, Mom and I will wash him afterwards. But what I love about my kids is the innocence of their faith. That they get excited about the things of God. And they want to surround themselves with reminders of who he is and how important he is to them. In fact, this morning as Abigail and I were out in the car and pulling in to the church here, she said to me, she said, Dad, I've decided that I am going to will everything I have to the church. She's 11 years old and very healthy. I said, Abigail, why? Why do you want to will everything you have to the church? She says, I don't know, Dad. I just think it's a good idea. The church is good. I want to give everything I have. I said, Abigail, when did you reach this epiphany in your 11 years of life? She said, I don't know, about 30 seconds ago. She'll probably do it too. Well, friends, I love the innocence. Jesus said, unless you become like a little child, you won't even enter the kingdom of heaven. How many of you know that when people are faithful to the Lord, that faithfulness, young and old, that example spreads the joy of the Lord to everyone around them? See, laughter is contagious. In Genesis chapter 21, we read about Abraham and Sarah who were getting up there in years. And as they approached the triple digits, they thought, there's no way God's going to keep that promise to give us a baby. In fact, they had found back doors. They cheated, came up with other ways to accomplish on their own what God had promised he would do. And then God said to Sarah, you will bear a son. And she busted up laughing. It's not going to happen. And the Lord said, "Are you laughing?" And then that son came. Can you imagine? What will people think? What will they say? Would they even believe? Or would they just think she has some eating disorder? That woman needs to lay off the sweets. Look at her. Moment on the lips, lifetime on the hips. And yet the day came when Sarah had a baby. And in Genesis 21, verses 6 and 7, we read, Sarah said, "God has brought me laughter, and everyone who hears about this will laugh with me." And she added, "Who would have said to Abraham and Sarah that Sarah would nurse children? Yet I have borne him a son in his old age." I have borne him a son in his old age. She had given up on a God-sized dream, and God said, "I said I'd never leave you until I fulfilled my promise." The people didn't laugh at her. They laughed with her. Because laughter is contagious. It's unbelievable what God can do. It's perhaps the greatest testimony that we have. And that's what drives us. It's what compels us to serve Him. Whatever season of life we're in, with whatever gifts we have and whatever energy we can muster, God calls us to fruitful labor. In Psalm 126, verses 4 through 6, we read, "Restore our fortunes, Lord, like the streams in Negev. Those who sow with tears will reap with songs of joy. Those who go out weeping, carrying seed to sow, will return with songs of joy, carrying sheaves with them." It's interesting that in the middle of this joyful time, there's a reminder that the struggles and the sorrows of life are no laughing matter. That the challenges we face and our hardships and our work is no joke. But hard work brings joy for the Christ follower. In Ecclesiastes chapter 5, beginning at verse 18, we read, "This is what I have observed to be good, that it is appropriate for a person to eat, to drink, and to find satisfaction in their toilsome labor under the sun during the few days of life God has given them, for this is their lot, to find satisfaction in their toilsome labor, not to kick back, but to engage, to find fulfillment in whatever we put our hearts, our hands, our minds, and our voices to be occupied with gladness." We continue reading in Ecclesiastes 5, verse 19. "Moreover, when God gives someone wealth and possessions, and the ability to enjoy them, to accept their lot and be happy in their toil, this is a gift from God. They seldom reflect on the days of their life because God keeps them occupied with gladness of heart." What an interesting passage. You see the part about wealth and possessions and the ability to enjoy them? And most of us would call that easy street, right? "But those whom God gives wealth and possessions and the ability to enjoy them must accept their lot and be happy in their toil." It takes work. It's not about the amount of wealth. It's not about the amount of possessions. It's about the ability to enjoy what God has provided and to press forward for His goodness and His glory, because He gives us all that we need for life and godliness. And when we see everything that we have as a gift from God, when we celebrate His goodness every day in every season, regardless of the circumstances, then we stop looking back at the good old days and trying to recapture something that happened in the past that is gone forever, and we begin to walk forward into something greater that God has for you and me today. Friends, I want to encourage you. God will keep us occupied with gladness of heart. Friends, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 11, beginning at verse 28, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." The yoke is a symbol of labor, of work, of toil. And Jesus said that when we are yoked to him, he will do the heavy lifting. He will walk beside us. Many of us see opportunities. We think that's for somebody else. Perhaps the Holy Spirit would say, you are that somebody. There is no somebody else. Seize the opportunity to make an impact in someone's life, to share the love and the laughter that only comes when you have been filled with the joy of the Lord. And if you don't know what that's like, if you don't know what it means to have the weight lifted with laughter, then I want to encourage you to connect with Jesus today.